Peter Schrager, popular co-host of Good Morning Football and FoxSports.com senior national writer. He joins us on the program. Good morning, Peter. How are you, buddy?
Good morning. So happy to be with you, Dan. It's been a while.
Would your wife like a calendar?
Yeah, I heard that. The topless option is an interesting one. Is it a gag gift or is this like, no, you might really like seeing Andrew Perloff with his shirt off for 31 days. I don't know if that's...
Well,
if that's
you'll gag. That's the gag gift part of it.
That's good.
Yes. But I don't know if, you know, Good Morning Football, if Kay would like to have one of these calendars.
We can not want to have one.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's stocking stuffer, but, you know, we have all kinds of...
crap lying around that office. Yeah, I might as well see what we got.
Okay. Is it... We just had Kenny Pickett on last hour, and I'm wondering... Are we at the point where there's going to be a quarterback taken number one overall? Like, does a quarterback have to go number one overall this year, even if we don't have that Trevor Lawrence type quarterback?
Yeah, it's such a fascinating deal because there's this double-edged sword of saying, well, yeah, we want to hype up the young quarterbacks and we want to, but almost like the MVP award in the NFL right now, finding that quarterback in college in the draft, it's not a slam dunk on any of them. And I don't know. And especially with Russell Wilson and Aaron Rodgers and maybe Jimmy Garoppolo and who knows who else being available in the veteran market, teams might address their quarterback needs in March. And it would lead to an interesting April because, Dan, I'll be honest, I'm one of the draft guys on NFL Network. It's a business. We got the combine. There is not the Trevor Lawrence this year. There's not that Zach Wilson this year. You could argue there's not a Justin Fields, Trey Lance, or Mac Jones this year. So if we're going to, by default, have to hype one of these guys. Well, sure, Pickett has had a great year, and he's been awesome at Pitt, and we can make a case for a lot of these guys, and the kid from Nevada and Carson Strong, but it's not like this 12-month buzz that we got with these other guys that we knew, like, hey, this is going to be a great quarterback crop.
All right, if not a quarterback, then who do you think would be the number one overall pick?
I don't know if he's eligible or not, or if he's going to become number 97 in Michigan. Steve Hutchinson's son, Aiden Hutchinson, has put on such a show over the last 2 weeks on these nationally televised games that there becomes this momentum and it becomes this.
Wait, is he in the Bosa conversation?
I think so. I think he's viewed as that high. You know,
okay.
The Oregon Thibodeau has had a ton of hype as well. This might be the year where it's a defensive end, and we've had Miles Garrett and Mario Williams and Jadeveon Clowney in the past, but Aiden Hutchinson's stock has been on fire for the last month. As Michigan wins, so does his draft status.
I was wondering about NBC has Bears and Packers.
Yeah.
Should they flex out of that? Can they flex out of that? There's Bills, Buccaneers, Niners, Bengals, Raiders, Chiefs, Ravens, Browns. Or do you want to see Packers, you know, Aaron Rodgers against the Bears maybe the final time?
Maybe. Yeah. I thought he already declared that he owned them. They can't flex out now. I'll say this. There is something to having those name brands out there. And if this is the Bears, their last stand with Nagy and whatever it is, all right, fine. It's Rodgers. You look at this slate, CBS isn't going to give up that Bucks Bills game. That's too good for them in that window. And, you know, what are you taking? Are you taking Bengals 49ers? Are you going, you know, the Fox isn't giving up Cowboys versus Washington.
Okay, so, but who decides what you give up? If NBC, it used to be NBC was able to take these games, weren't they?
Yeah.
Now, who decides that if, you know, obviously Fox wants to hold on to the Cowboys or Bills Bucks is spicy for CBS, but if NBC had wanted to flex, could they, and were there games that would be off limits there?
You know, historically, you're right. I think they get to pick it, but it has to be, it's usually 2 weeks in advance. You usually get that 10-day window where they're saying, okay, no, that's going to be flexed out. They didn't flex it out. There's something to seeing Rodgers on Sunday Night Football still. You know, for all the national televised games he's had, I don't recall one this season where he's been on Sunday night. So maybe this is Al, Chris, and Michelle and their opportunity to do a Rodgers game. And that's kind of like, hey, we're good with this. Let's just roll with Rodgers.
Are we fighting the urge to give Tom Brady the MVP or fighting the urge to acknowledge that the Patriots could actually be a really good team?
Yeah, I think we're fighting the urge on both. And I think the Brady thing, I said it on Good Morning Football as people were, you know, breaking their back, making the case for TJ Watt or Jonathan Taylor. And it's like, well, if you look at Why are we? Brady's been amazing. Brady's been amazing. Leads the league in every statistical category. His team is atop their division. They're rolling. They're like, is this the Michael Jordan thing where, you know, Charles Barkley wins an MVP and Karl Malone wins an MVP, and then we start arguing about Clyde Drexler? Is he going to be the guy? This, you know, and then Jordan's like, it's been me all along. And that's maybe what it is with Brady. There's a fatigue from the voters, but also in the desire to crown the next young quarterback, we've rotated from, you know, whether it be Lamar early in the season to then Kyler, and then, hey, it's Josh Allen's year, and maybe it's just the greatest of all time, and it's okay to vote for him for MVP, as bored as the voting populace might be with it.
He's Peter Schrager, co-host of NFL Network's Good Morning Football, FoxSports.com, senior national writer. Let me go back to Kenny Pickett there for a moment. He almost went to Temple, and I believe Matt Rhule was at Temple. Now Matt Rhule's at Carolina. Carolina could use a quarterback. I wonder if you could, although there's been talk that maybe Matt Rhule firing his offensive coordinator, Joe Brady, to hold on to his job, and maybe he goes back to college. I don't know, but I'm wondering, maybe you could connect the dots and Carolina could be in business with Kenny Pickett.
Maybe. I mean, my read on the Joe Brady thing, and this comes from pretty good intelligence, was like, it wasn't working. And I think they both say that it wasn't working this season. And now Joe Brady's going to get pick of the litter for one of these college offensive coordinator jobs or one of these head coaching jobs that's still available in college. And that he might look at that and be like, that's a backhanded thing to say that I'm not ready for the NFL. But here, doing it now, if they weren't going to be going into the offseason as is, doing it now in December is a lot better for him job-wise than in late January, whenever they would have done it. Kenny Pickett, that pick is going to be analyzed for years. They went with J.C. Horn, a cornerback, over Justin Fields and over Mac Jones. And that'll be picked apart a million ways. I still think they're going to be players, though, in the veteran market. And I, you know, watch what they did with Sam Darnold and Cam Newton. Just wait till this offseason. I could see Tepper and, of course, Scott Fitter, the GM, and then the head coach, Matt Rhule, saying, let's go for broke, whether it be Watson, Russell Wilson, Rodgers, Garoppolo, whatever it is, saying, hey, let's find our quarterback. We don't need to rely on a rookie to do this.
Why is there revisionist history with people's opinion on Mac Jones?
Hey, I love you asking that. Can I tell you something? Very, very seldom do I pat myself on the back publicly. I was the biggest Mac Jones like guy, and I got crushed for 2 months on Good Morning Football, being like, he's a stiff, he's not athletic. Of course you like him, he's not as dynamic. But everything that I heard leading up to the draft, and you probably heard the same stuff, was like, he is athletic, he's as smart as they come, and he's actually a great leader. All those Alabama kids swore by him, whether it was Waddle or Smith or the class before that. Anytime we interviewed them on our show, it was like, Mac's the guy. And sometimes we'd even try to pit Tua versus Mac, and a lot of them would be like, no, Mac's a dog. So I think it's crazy that when all of us in the media had, you know, the 49ers taking Mac at 3, the response wasn't, I don't think your information's good. The response was, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard in the world. Well, I don't know. Mac Jones looks pretty good to me. And Mac Jones looks pretty competent. And he handed the ball off really well on Monday night. And you could laugh at, like, hey, he did nothing. It takes a pretty different kind of kid to say, hey, I'm cool with this game plan. Whatever it takes to go get the win, I'm fine with being the
okay,
butt of a few
jokes.
Okay,
if Brady was still quarterbacking the Patriots.
I don't know. You tell me, do you think
how many passes do you think Brady throws against Buffalo Monday night?
I think out of respect to Tom Brady, you don't do that game plan. And I think it takes a first-year neophyte quarterback, and I think it takes a coach and an offensive coordinator with as much equity as they do, and with a quarterback as little equity as Mac Jones does, to make that happen. I don't think Brady stomachs a 2-for-3. Maybe I'm wrong. Brady might be listening to this and be like, I'll do anything for a win. I don't know.
Where do you stand on the Taysom Hill experiment?
Got 5 more weeks. Let's see how this goes. He's a great...
He's 31 years of age, Peter.
I know.
He's not 25.
I know. And he's injured now, and he's got the foot, and he's got the other issue with the finger. And Sean Payton's going to will it to happen one way or another. We're going to find out. So you have the next few weeks to decide on Taysom Hill.
Oh, my God. Are the Bills still a Super Bowl contender?
Tough. I said the word emasculating on air, and I got a lot of feedback from like Bills fans. Like, now wait, that's a line too far. But to lose the way they lost to Indianapolis at home, and we celebrate the table smashing and the crazy Bills fans and how hard it is to play up there. And then to lose to the Patriots the way they did on Monday night, that's really hard to bounce
back from. They've lost to every quality team. Remember when they lost to the Steelers opening week and we're like, golly.
That's an oddity. Yeah.
Is it? Maybe not so much now when you think about it. And I said this after the game yesterday. It's a Buffalo team not built for Buffalo weather.
No, but that's the thing. It's like you go in like, oh, playing up in Buffalo in December. Yeah, it's uncomfortable for anybody, but they're not built necessarily to be a run heavy and then stop the run team. And they've been exposed the last few weeks. I think we're going to learn a lot about that team, that organization, and those players over the next few weeks, how they bounce back. How they show up against Tampa on Sunday will tell us a lot, because everyone's writing them off. And if Josh Allen is this next level, top five quarterback, throw it on me, I'll get it done guy, he goes and wins this game in Tampa and says, no, you everybody here, just hang on. We still got something here. I want to see what he brings.
As Peter was talking, and didn't want to pat himself on the back, so I'll do that. He said this about Mac Jones. The basement on Mac Jones, from everyone you talk to, the basement is Kirk Cousins. The ceiling, if he's unbelievable, he's the perfect prospect, might be Drew Brees. That's from April.
Not bad, considering he's a stiff.
You're not supposed to say not bad. I was complimenting you.
Dan, I once said that Russell Wilson was a reach in the third round. So I wear it. I wear it when I get him wrong. I once said that Reuben Foster and Solomon Thomas were going to change the face of the 49ers forever. I mean, I wear it when I get it wrong. But Mac Jones, it was 100 out of 100 across the board from football people. And yet there was this great resistance, because here's this one-year guy who looks like Howdy Doody coming out of Alabama, which doesn't really churn out NFL quarterbacks. I don't know. I think he was my number two rated quarterback after Trevor Lawrence. That includes Zach Wilson, who everyone just assumed was number two. So that's just my one of those that I'm like, hey, I'm going to take some credit for that, even if people still are doubting him.
I whiffed on Solomon Thomas.
A lot of us did.
Yeah. I whiffed on Logan Thomas as well.
Oh, had an awesome arm at Virginia Tech, right?
I thought he was going to win the Heisman Trophy.
Me too. I loved Logan Thomas in college.
Hey, but he's in the NFL playing tight end.
He is. He's having a nice career. We can go down the list, but I was one of the huge Matt Barkley fans too. Like, and Matt Barkley's had a great NFL career. He's been a backup, but like, I was one of those who's like, during the college season, that's a top 10 pick inside and out. And that's when I learned to not just top off my head and maybe talk to people in the NFL who know things before I start saying things.
Yes, McLovin.
This is very educational for me. I've actually never whiffed yet, but if I do, I'll know how to handle it gracefully like you guys.
Is this gracefully?
Did you ever hear what McLovin had to say about Blake Bortles or Blaine Gabbert or Cam Newton? Did you ever hear this?
No. What was that? What was the take?
Let me see if we have it.
Cam Newton's not close. He's 3 years away, and Gabbert's more pro-ready right now.
Yeah. So
he won rookie of the year right out of the gate. Maybe one of the best rookie seasons we've ever seen.
Imagine if he'd have been ready, Pete.
I mean, just imagine if we gave him 3 years to learn from Steve Berline or Chris Wankie or Jimmy Clausen.
Was Good Morning Football in the running for McLovin since he's leaving this show at the end of the year? Did anybody, like, was anybody's job maybe in jeopardy, expendable, now they knew that McLovin was going to be available in the open market?
It's one of those players where you're like, we'll never get our hands on him. So we didn't even make the overture. We had no idea. I will say this. I love you guys as a group, and good luck, McLovin, and all your endeavors. You're awesome, man.
Yes, McLovin.
When Nate Burleson left, I think the natural connection was receiving skills.
Oh, okay.
That was it. Never mind. I was going to make a knock at Nate, but now people are like, ooh, that'll be like media news. But anyway, we love everyone.
Well, Nate's big time now. Like, he doesn't really have much time for you guys, does he?
Good luck answering my call. No, he's busy with Gayle King.
Yeah, I know. Okay. Yeah. And Oprah. Does he call her? Oh, like, what's that work with Nate? How's that work?
What, when they're in Montecito together? Oh, yeah, I don't know. Wow. I don't know how that all works.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. That's nice.
Yeah. Sitting in a cubicle right now, by the way, Dan, doing this. So, yeah, just so you know the difference between me and Nate right now.
You have made it.
Yes.
Your career is sky. Do you have a game this weekend?
I'll be in studio for Fox doing a little pregame stuff with them for this. We have an awesome matchup with Washington and Dallas. Suddenly, that's a game. I love it.
Is there a rivalry between you and Jay Glazer?
No. No, okay. They're actually very fond of each other and get along well. Jay's got a lot more cool things going on off the field than me. I usually go home and like eat a Polio string cheese. Jay is out with like Stallone and David Spade or something.
Glazer does rub shoulders with some of the elite there.
He's the man.
Yeah. I like how he'll do a cameo and break his story and then go back to his regular life.
That's it.
Like, oh, damn. I gotta.
And they're massive. They're massive. He'll break huge stories and like go back to working out with Demi Lovato. And I'm sitting here like grinding away for ankle injury news. Like, what's Russell Gage's ankle look like? Yeah, that's it.
All right. Well, keep your head up, okay?
Thanks. We'll get there.
Thank you, Peter. That's Peter Schrager, co-host NFL Network's Good Morning Football, FoxSports.com, senior NFL writer.